Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Our 2019 commencement ceremony is about to begin. Please rise and welcome the Western University of Health Sciences College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific Northwest graduating class of 2019.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Western University of Health Sciences Commencement 2019 at the campus of WesternU, Oregon. Today's ceremony honors graduates from the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific Northwest. Please take a moment to locate the nearest exit in case of emergency. That door may not be the same one you entered through. Please silence all electronic devices, including tablets and cell phones. For the safety of everyone, please keep aisles clear at all times. Please do not approach the stage during the diploma and hooding ceremony. Following today's event, you may meet your graduate at the patio on the south side of the Boulder Falls Center by the Japanese Garden. All guests and graduates are invited to an open house at Comp Northwest following today's ceremony. Thank you. Family and friends. Your loved one is among many talented men and women graduating from Western University of Health Sciences as caring and compassionate healthcare professionals. Today, they proudly walk across this stage. Tomorrow, they boldly take their place among the healers of the world. Please rise now to meet the class of 2019.
Hello, I'm Dr. Daniel Wilson, President of Western University of Health Sciences. Welcome to our honored guests, the family and friends of today's graduates. As our university has evolved, your loved ones have also transformed from students into health professionals. This is thanks to learning opportunities in our classrooms and clinics, laboratories and libraries, interprofessional education, and endless interaction with patients and professionals in their fields. We join you today in celebrating your loved one's achievements.
To teach, to heal, together, Western University of Health Sciences. We honor the fifth class to graduate from WesternU's Oregon campus. From the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific Northwest, this college is part of the most comprehensive health sciences institution in the country, Western University of Health Sciences. It all began in 1977 with the founding of a small medical school called the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific. From renovated storefront buildings in downtown Pomona, California, the founders set forth on a mission to prepare primary care physicians to meet healthcare needs in the Western United States. Under the leadership of Dr. Philip Pomerantz, the school's long-serving first president, 36 students were enrolled in the charter class, which graduated in 1982. Soon, the small campus expanded to serve the medical needs of the surrounding Pomona Valley, as well as the educational needs of the nation's healthcare professions. In 1996, the college was restructured as Western University of Health Sciences and began welcoming several new colleges, all committed to the founding value of humanism. A second campus opened in 2011 in Lebanon, Oregon, to address critical health care needs in the Pacific Northwest. And in 2016, the university named its second permanent president, Dr. Daniel R. Wilson. Today, nearly 4,000 students attend WesternU's two campuses. They come from all over America and the world, seeking degrees in 20 health sciences programs. Encouraged by people like you, their family and friends, who support them on their life-changing journeys through WesternU. Listen how a few of today's graduates describe the sacrifices their loved ones have made.
From the first day of classes, my wife Taylor has always encouraged me to do my absolute best. Taylor, you always allowed me to be selfish with my studies and take the time I needed to become a physician. You are my absolute rock throughout this challenging time, and I thank you for standing by my side and supporting me. Taylor, you are the best. Now let's celebrate.
My mom, Lorna C. Anderson, and my dad, Phil, both lovingly call me their number one fan. My mom, throughout medical school, has proven this countless times, and my dad has always truly believed in me. Your unfaltering support played a pivotal role in my success, and I will always remain your number one fan.
Through her hard work, dedication, and passion, my fellow graduate, best friend, and now wife, Lexi Buffington, inspired me to push my limits and strive towards my best self. I smile thinking back to our study break basketball sessions and just how competitive they would get. First Lady Alexis Whitney Buffington III, Esquire, Mother of Dragons, Smeller of Flowers, Counter of Pennies, and Knower of All Things to Know. I love you, and I'm so grateful for this crazy journey we are on together.
My husband, Justin Moss, had such steadfast confidence in me that I had confidence in myself when going through medical school. Justin, during my first year, I remember coming home after every test, feeling certain I had failed. You wrapped me up in a blanket, poured me a warm cup of tea, and placed our cats on my lap, and always gave me reassurance.
My father, Faridun, my mother, Farangis, and my sister, Foya, gave me the tools and put me in the best position to succeed in medical school. Mom and Dad, as you know, my first 2 years of medical school revolved around studying. I barely had enough time to cook for myself. Knowing that, you guys took the time to make pre-frozen, home-cooked meals and would drive them down to me every month from Beaverton all the way down to Lebanon. So thank you. And Foya, Thanks for always having my back, sis. I love you.
Without the support of my husband, Derek, I don't believe that I would have been able to achieve my goal of becoming a physician. Derek, your loving support means the world to me. And don't worry, I haven't forgotten my promise to get you a fishing boat someday. Hi, Nora and Leah.
After my second year at WesternU, I had to take a break in my studies. And my wife, Holly, was the fundamental reason I was able to continue my pursuit of medicine. During this already challenging time, you gave birth to our daughter, Adeline, and a month ago, our son, Emmerich. None of this would have been possible without you and our family support.
My mom and dad, Teresa and Mark, have been supportive and encouraging every step of the way through medical school. They've kept me sane these past 4 years. Mom, Dad, every other weekend you would drive down from Washington to Lebanon and bring me care packages and make sure I was getting appropriate downtime from school. Mom, Dad, thank you for your unyielding support.
My wife, Michelle, has mastered the art of helping me through the stressful times in medical school. If you knew I was studying late, you would load up the car with our three wonderful and rambunctious children, Elena, Eli, and Emery, and you would drive to school and bring me a gourmet meal. Mrs. Bear, you helped make the impossible possible. I love you, and I'm so grateful for your support.
My fiance, Spencer Huso, has been there for me every step of the way on my journey through medical school. Spencer, I love that I didn't even have to ask you to start this journey with me. From day one, you said, well, I guess we are moving to Oregon. You've been there for me throughout the late nights, the long study days, and through it all, you've comforted me, cheered me on, and even challenged me.
My incredible husband, Captain Anthony Hillesheim, is deserving of my thanks for helping me get through medical school. Tony, from the early morning phone calls to get me out of bed, to the meal planning and fitness programs, to helping me get through the emotional fatigue of studying for boards and starting a new job every month, I simply cannot imagine where I would be without your constant support, encouragement, and love. I love you most, Tony.
The love, inspiration, and support of my parents, Kevin and Diane, got me to where I am right now. Mom, I remember you saying, whatever the mind can conceive, you can achieve. But there was a time when my confidence faltered and the weight of life pushed me down to a really dark place. There were people that reached out to me, but it was you, Mom and Dad, that really helped me once again find that light and purpose in life. You literally saved me. Mom and Dad, I love you.
Hello, I'm Dr. Paula Crone, Dean of the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific and Comp Northwest, and Vice President of the WesternU Oregon campus. As our graduates commence across the stage, we recognize the support of their loved ones, the greater WesternU family, and the members of our Lebanon and Oregon communities. With this wide network of support, our campus and our students continue to thrive, and today, we graduate a new generation of physicians. From all of us at WesternU, we say thank you.
Congratulations to family and friends gathered here today.
As we just heard, you have all played an important role.
Without you, your loved one's educational journey might not have happened.
So take a few moments to pat yourselves on the back. You have earned it.
Now, graduates, on to even greater adventures. Commencement, after all, means beginning. On your new journeys, remember that healing is a blend of technical skill and compassion. With both, you are ready to enhance health, save lives, and reduce suffering.
We wish you every success.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise now to meet the people who have helped to guide your loved ones on their journey through WesternU. The faculty, administration, and board of trustees. The Dean of the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific and Comp Northwest, Dr. Paula M. Crone, and the President of Western University of Health Sciences, Dr. Daniel R. Wilson.
Western University of Health Sciences, Dr. Daniel R. Wilson. Performed this morning by Praise in 3D, followed by our invocation.
So proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave?
Gentlemen, Pastor Patrick Bowler of Valley Life Church, who will offer today's invocation.
My son, he's 9, youngest of 5, came in for a hug the other day, as he often does, and he said, "I love you, Dad." He's a fairly affectionate kid. I thought I'd dig a little bit. "Son, you say that a lot. What is love?" To which he said without skipping a beat, "It's a pretty big deal." Well, today is a pretty big deal. Historic, even. And I'm compelled to ask, what was it all for? The sacrifice, the cost, the hard work, miles away from family, the long hours, etc. What was it all for? In the scriptures, in the book of Genesis, God called Abraham to leave his family and his home too. And what for? Let me read. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. "Now the Lord said to Abram, 'Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make you a great nation. And I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed.'" What was it all for? God blessed Abraham. God made Abraham's name great. For what purpose? To what end? It says so that he would be a blessing. Ultimately, that all of the families of the earth would be blessed. Now, I'm a Christian pastor, and I understand that to be a reference to Jesus, who would one day come and redeem the world from sin. But in principle, I would ask you, why would God bless you? Why would he make your name great? And I think the answer is the same, that you too would be a blessing. In 1973, I was born across the street. I've been around a while. Due to complications, I was born 2 months early. Fast forward 26 years, and my daughter's also born 2 months early. 50% chance of survival. They were monoamniotic. And this year they turned 20, and one is getting married this August. My point is this. God bless the doctors, nurses, and staff that they would in turn be a blessing to me, to my parents, to my wife, and to my daughters. So again, what was it all for? We have been blessed to be a blessing. So today is a big deal. Congratulations to you, your family, and to all those who will one day find themselves blessed because of you. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, it says in Scripture that all good gifts come from you. Today is a pretty big deal, a good gift to these students, their families, and all those that they will one day serve. Thank you. I would ask that you continue to bless these graduates, and in so doing, that they would in turn be a blessing to others. I pray this in Jesus' name for their good and your glory. Amen.
Please welcome the President of Western University of Health Sciences, Dr. Daniel R. Wilson.
Thank you. Please be seated. To members of the class of 2019, faculty, honored guests, trustees, administrators, Comp Northwest Advancement Board, alumni, family, and friends, welcome to the 38th annual commencement exercises for Western University of Health Sciences. As you may know, WesternU began in 1977 simply as the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific. Our charter class graduated in 1982 with 31 new doctors of osteopathic medicine receiving their diplomas. By way of comparison, as commencement exercises for all nine colleges conclude, this year alone we will have awarded 1,071 degrees. That is some 35 times the number of the charter class. Today marks the official culmination of a specific course of study for all graduating students, but it does not signify an end to their education. As technically proficient health professionals and humanistic healers, WesternU graduates are also lifelong learners. Therefore, while commencement marks an ending, it equally marks the start of something new. So let all of us, graduates, families, faculty, guests, this day celebrate the tremendous academic accomplishments these diplomas represent. Yet let us also celebrate the mystery, excitement, and challenges of journeys newly begun. Our faculty know much about what such journeys are like, for each has walked a similar path. Even as we honor our graduates, our faculty too should be honored. There is nowhere a group of professionals more committed to student success than at Western University of Health Sciences. However, success is about more than good study habits, good grades, and good careers. It is about setting high standards for care, compassion, conscientiousness, and character. Our faculty have a deep interest in these core qualities. That our students become superb health professionals indelibly shaped by humanistic science defines the very mission of the university. Yet equally, if not more important to our faculty than mere academic achievement, is the type of human being who emerges from our tutelage. Our faculty believe kindness, generosity, good humor, and common sense are as essential to healthcare as a stethoscope or a blood test. Moreover, they impart these values in the most effective way possible, leading by examples in lives lived to serve others. I ask that our superb faculty rise to be recognized. Commencement is a swirl of emotions, happiness, pride, confidence, and especially for the graduates, relief. You made it. You survived the late nights, the early mornings, the endless study, the mad scrambles for breakout rooms. You conquered anatomy, or at least made peace with it. You powered through rotations and community service. You kept your goal in sight, and today you have attained it. Along the way, you have been sustained by friends, partners, family members, and classmates. Every one of you graduates, and all who helped each of you along the way, sharing in the setbacks and triumphs, must be rightly proud and joyful today. We congratulate you, all of you. It is now my privilege to introduce our provost, Dr. Gary Googlechuck, who will soon enter active emeritus status after some 33 years of remarkable service to the university. Dr. Googlechuck will share a happy review of how much is in motion with our commencement exercises.
Thank you, President Wilson. Last week, five ceremonies were held in Pasadena, California. The Graduate College of Biomedical Sciences and the Colleges of Health Sciences, Pharmacy, and Dental Medicine ceremonies were held on May 22nd. The Colleges of Optometry, Graduate Nursing, and Veterinary Medicine on May 23rd. And the College of Podiatric Medicine and the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific Pomona on May 24th. Each of these celebrations includes what is perhaps the most meaningful feature of a WesternU commencement, the hooding ceremony. At our very first commencement 37 years ago, we asked our graduates to designate a special person who would formally place the academic hood on them after taking their diploma in hand. That practice continues to this day. This is one of the ways WesternU acknowledges and honors the contributions and support of those who help our students reach their goals. As you will soon see, many graduates will be hooded by members of their families. Another important tradition is the presentation of a university lapel pin to each graduate. They will be presented. They will be presented by our alumni representative, Jeff Bulkley, D.O., class of 2015. The pin is offered as a gift to the newest members of our alumni family and bears a university seal and the degree that the graduate has earned. We hope the graduates will wear the pin often and with pride as ambassadors for Western University of Health Sciences and for the health professions. Also, I should take a moment to express appreciation for all those who make all this magic happen, notably the remarkable work of our commencement team under the leadership of Dr. Maribel Fernandez-Paul, Comp Northwest Assistant Dean for Student Affairs, as well as the Departments of Information Technology, Facilities, and Public Affairs. And special mention is due to Kelsey Anglin and One Source Strategy. Finally, last week, the university bestowed on me an honorary doctoral degree. I want to take this opportunity to thank the president and the board of trustees for this rare recognition. And I'm proud to say that I, too, am a member of the class of 2019. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Googlechuck. That might make you the eldest member of the class of 2000. Western University of Health Sciences is special in many ways, not least in how so many of our alumni continue to serve the university with steadfastness and affection. One alumnus has both a unique place in university history as well as a truly special role. It is my privilege to introduce the chair of our Board of Trustees, Dr. Richard Bond, who is the very first graduate of the university. On behalf of the board, Dr. Bond has a warm welcome for the graduates and guests. As Dr. Bond comes to the podium, I ask that all our trustees present rise and be recognized.
Thank you, President Wilson. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It is my honor and pleasure to be with you today representing the Board of Trustees. Over the years, we have come to realize each class has a fascinating personality of its own. Let me give you a snapshot of this year's candidates. Of the 104 graduates here today, there are 51 women and 53 men. Their average age is 30. Many have already had interesting careers, for example, lifeguard, engineer, Peace Corps volunteer. When they have received their diplomas, the total number of WesternU alumni from all programs will be 16,469. To me, that's an awesome number. When I graduated, the number was 31. Let me now speak to the graduates. Today, you receive your degrees and wonder, perhaps, where you'll go. And I tell you, nowhere but up. Today, you're on top of the world and think there is nothing higher. But there's a reason graduation is called commencement. For now, you commence the important work of the rest of your lives. Take with you the quest to be lifelong learners, and let humanism as well as science be the base of all your actions. You are destined for great things. We knew this when we chose each one of you, and we know it even more so today. Congratulations.
Thank you, Dr. Bond. Now I wish to call to the podium Dean Paula Crone, who will present our candidates for honorary degrees.
Dr. Pham, please escort the Honorable Barbara K. Roberts to the podium. Mr. President, I have for your consideration the Honorable Barbara K. Roberts, candidate for an honorary degree. By virtue of serving as the 34th governor of the state of Oregon and of a lifetime of distinguished service, Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present Barbara K. Roberts as a candidate for the degree of Doctor of Humane Letters, honoris causa.
Thank you, Dean Crone. Now, by the honor vested in me by the Board of Trustees, I hereby confer upon you, the Honorable Barbara K. Roberts, the degree of Doctor of Humane Letters, honoris causa, with all the rights, honors, and privileges appertaining thereto. In witness whereof, I cause you to be invested with the hood appropriate to the degree and grant you a diploma.
Dr. Pham, please escort Governor Kate Brown to the podium. Mr. President. Mr. President, I have for your consideration the Honorable Kate Brown, candidate for an honorary degree. By virtue of serving as the 38th governor of the state of Oregon and of a lifetime of distinguished service, Mr. President, it is my pleasure to present the Honorable Kate Brown, a candidate for the degree of Doctor of Humane Letters, honoris causa.
Thank you, Dean Crone. Now, by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees, I hereby confer upon you, Governor Kate Brown, the degree of Doctor of Humane Letters, honoris causa, with all the rights, honors, and privileges appertaining thereto. In witness whereof, I cause you to be invested with the hood appropriate to the degree and grant you a diploma.
This morning represents a truly historic moment as we are honored by having the only two female governors of the state of Oregon on our stage together today. In fact, this may be the first time this has occurred on any university commencement stage across the country. Both of these women have served as role models and as examples to many of us. Their influence and their impact is far-reaching. It is my pleasure to introduce Oregon's Governor, Kate Brown. Governor Brown started her career in public service in 1991 when she was appointed to the Oregon House of Representatives. She was later elected to the Oregon State Senate and shortly after was elected by her peers to serve as the Senate Democratic leader. From 2009 to 2015, Governor Brown has served as Oregon Secretary of State. Like Governor Roberts before her, she has broken barriers throughout her career. Her public service record extends almost 30 years, and she is a mainstay in Oregon politics, fighting passionately to improve our state's educational and healthcare systems. Today, she is also a proud aunt of one of our graduates, Megan Smith. Please. Please join me in welcoming Governor Kate Brown.
Good morning, and thank you, Dean Crone, for that very generous introduction. I am so honored to deliver the governor's address to the class of 2019. Congratulations. We are so proud of all of you. Top Northwest has impressed me as truly a special place. And I'm not just saying that because my niece is among today's graduates. This is a place where, through a potent mixture of caffeine, adrenaline, and perspiration, you are transformed from a regular person into a doctor of osteopathic medicine. The way forward is illuminated by this noble calling to preserve and improve the life and health of people. In a moment, you will recite the rest of the osteopathic oath. You will promise to accept each of your patients as a part of your family for years to come. You promise to protect fiercely their secrets, like family. And you promise to meet people where they are at, rather than wish them to be, just like your family. Your charge is greater than to simply do no harm. It was the founder of osteopathic medicine, Andrew Taylor Still, who said, "To find health should be the object of the doctor. Anyone can find disease." Your training has taught you sitting on that crunchy exam table paper is a whole person, someone with a job, a family, with their own worries and dreams. Maybe they come to you in pain. Maybe they carry scars from a complex past. But they come, as all human beings do, seeking hope for the future, for themselves, for their loved ones. They are looking at you. You depart these halls today into a world that desperately needs your brains, your energy, and your dedication to create a more ethical, compassionate, and inclusive world. Healthcare is a huge part of that. Take your classmate, Amir. Amir knows firsthand how strong the mind-body connection can be, as he was born with cerebral palsy. His condition made childhood activities like playing soccer or riding a bike nearly impossible. But Amir did not allow his cerebral palsy to define him. He turned to music. Playing the piano not only fed his soul, but it improved his manual dexterity, giving him the tools to persevere through his physical limitations. The compassion he felt for others came from his own experience. It inspired his desire to transition from software engineering to osteopathic medicine. He realized that healing the whole person rather than just relieving pain can be the difference between surviving and thriving. You realize, he says, that your service has made them feel comfortable and satisfied, that their life is just a little bit better because of you. These special moments define a career. They make life beautiful and worth living. Amir told me, medicine is not just about cheering patients, but more importantly, it's about listening and caring. We live in a series of moments rocked by political upheaval and uncertainty. But when I look around this room, I see a light in each of you. I see your goodness, your determination to heal, to repair, to comfort, to banish despair and hopelessness, to shine your light into dark places. It takes a special person to do this very important work. I believe that person is you. I knew someone just like you, someone who changed the world one patient at a time. Senator Alan Bates from Medford was not only a talented and dedicated osteopathic physician, he fundamentally changed healthcare in the state of Oregon. Senator Bates was tireless. Each week during the legislative session, he would work late on Thursday, then drive 4 hours back to Medford to see his patients, 7 a.m. Friday morning all day, 7 a.m. Saturday morning all day, and Sunday morning, 7 a.m. too. And then on Monday, he'd drive back to Salem and do it all over again. In the legislature, he was everyone's doctor. If you were sick, you called Doc. Like all of you, he was in the business of caring for people. He believed that quality healthcare was about relationships, not just providing a service. At the end of one appointment day, just as he was heading out the door, one of his patients happened to mention that she was having a little shoulder pain. He turned around immediately and gave her his full attention. In the 30 years he'd known her, she'd never complained. Something was wrong. He wasted no time. Turns out she had an aortic aneurysm that would have killed her had it not been addressed immediately. He knew to investigate because he knew her. During Senator Bates' last year at the Capitol, Oregon was in a recession. Deep cuts to the Oregon Health Plan would leave hundreds of thousands of Oregonians without health care. Bates worked tirelessly to avoid that. He collaborated with legislators from both sides of the aisle to pass a bill which created our coordinated care organizations, or CCOs, which provide health care services to the Oregon Health Plan patients. Under the old model, you paid a fee for service. But Senator Bates knew that health care isn't just when you're at the doctor, it's about when you're not at the doctor. The CCOs work to mend the gaps in the health care fabric and stitch them back together. Like the patient in Curry County who popped his stitches 2 days post-op by chopping wood. The CCO model made it possible to deliver him enough wood to last the winter so that he could fully heal. Preventative care is cheaper, it's easier, and it's smarter. And providers drive the system, be it a nurse, a physician, or a dentist. In addition to being the right thing to do to serve our patients, the CCO model has saved taxpayers an estimated $2 billion over the last 5 years. The number of ER visits has plummeted, and the number of prenatal visits has jumped to 95%, which is unheard of. There's no question that one person, one dedicated person with good ideas can change the world. Senator Bates was that person, and so are you. Senator Bates showed us that a doctor can be many things, but most importantly, he showed us what can be done when we pay attention, when we listen to each other, when we care for one another. So go out there and relentlessly inflict good. Looking at your faces, I see pride, hope, and yes, immense relief. And I am reminded of Oregon's motto, "She flies with her own wings." Class of 2019, you stand on the edge of the nest, wings outstretched, sun on your face, the winds are in your favor, you are strong. You are ready to leap into the blue. So fly, soar, be the brilliant and talented healer you were meant to be. I can't wait to see what you do next. Congratulations and good luck. And now, I am also truly honored to introduce my very good friend and mentor, Governor Barbara Roberts, to deliver the commencement keynote address. Throughout Governor Roberts' long career in public service, her leadership has helped Oregon become a better place. As Oregon's first woman governor, she was a strong supporter of public education, disability rights and services, environmental management, and streamlining of state government. I have been so incredibly fortunate to benefit from her mentorship, her wisdom, and her advice for more than two decades. Please welcome the Honorable Barbara Roberts.
You're supposed to say that's a hard act to follow, and it is. Thank you very much, Governor Brown, for the lovely introduction, and what a joy to mentor someone who is so successful and makes every hour you gave in that mentoring process so valuable. So let me say first, good morning, and Governor Brown, President Wilson, Dean Crone, university faculty and administration, Board of Trustees, family and friends, and today's 104 graduates, 104 new osteopathic physicians. And as we all celebrate, I have the honor of delivering the commencement address to the class of 2019. The fifth graduating class of this College of Osteopathic Medicine. These new physicians formally enter the world of medicine at a time of great complexity, exciting innovation, new technology, high patient expectations, and heated political healthcare debate that seems to go on and on. These new doctors have made a life choice to enter one of this culture's most demanding professions. And they arrive at a period of growing medical changes and social challenges for their field. But we can be grateful for their brave life choice and thankful for the positive changes that they will deliver in their medical future. And I, too, have delivered thousands of speeches over the last four decades. Some of them were those rah-rah speeches that politicians so often do. There were addresses to the Rotary and Kiwanis groups, economic presentations being translated into Japanese, Korean, and German, book readings from my autobiography, and even convention oratory on national television. I've spoken to college classes and senior citizen groups and women's rights rallies and labor union conventions and brand new American citizens. But for me, the most challenging of all speeches is a commencement address. Think about it. A good portion of our graduates seated here today are really here just to please their families. They have parties planned and they have plane reservations made. Plus, commencement speeches are notoriously boring and usually quickly forgotten. So what can I say that will be more than simply out-of-date advice or useless platitudes? Am I able to share with you, this class, ideas that will be meaningful or useful and perhaps even a little bit memorable? Well, let me start with this admission. I have a history of telling citizens what I believe they need to know and not placating them with what they want to hear. So today I want to focus on a subject we speak far too little about, the issue of personal courage. Now, don't misunderstand me. I am not referring to running into a burning building or diving into a flooding river to rescue someone. I'm talking about the kind of personal courage it takes to speak out when you stand alone on an issue. I mean being strong enough to refuse to laugh at jokes that demean minorities, women, gays, and the disabled. I'm talking about admitting your mistakes. Thank you very much. I'm talking about admitting your mistakes and not trying to bury them. I'm referring to setting the record straight when the truth is being stretched, distorted, or just plain ignored. Yet realistically, personal courage can arrive as a surprise to any of us. Our own personal courage sometimes comes when we finally understand that our silence has become too costly. My entrance into politics began as a citizen advocate, a parent seeking justice. My older son, Mike, who is autistic, had been sent home from school in the first grade, not for the day, but forever. His disability meant he had no rights to a public school education. The laws in the mid-1960s gave my son no recognition, no rights, and no recourse. Finally, I could no longer accept the inequity. I began to speak out publicly about this injustice. I pleaded for help. I sought an advocate to champion the cause for children like Mike. They deserved an education. By the end of the 1960s, I was a divorced mother with two sons, no child support, and a low-paying office job. But I was unwilling to remain silent any longer. My son needed my strength. My son needed my courage. So I took a day a week off work and the really painful pay cut, traveled to the state capitol, and began a fight for Mike's educational rights. I was inexperienced and I was so damn scared. But I marched up those marble Capitol steps at that Capitol building, determined to bring educational fairness to Oregon's disabled children. I carried my message to every state representative and every state senator. I pleaded for my son's future. After 6 months of very hard work and steady persuasion, my legislation passed both houses and was signed into law by Governor Tom McCall. Oregon then had the first such special education rights law for children with emotional disabilities in the United States of America. I had changed my son's life and changed his future. My law, Oregon's new law, changed the lives of hundreds and eventually thousands of Oregon's children and their families. And my own life was never the same again. That first political success for my son cemented my belief that if your cause is just and if you are determined enough, and sometimes if you can be brave enough, one person can make a difference. I learned it way back then, and I believe it still. Sometimes when searching for a leader, we discover the leadership within ourselves. I guess you can see why I believe in citizen participation. Perhaps you can understand why I preach that democracy is not a spectator sport. Yet most of us look at ourselves and we don't see much courage within, maybe buried deeply, but maybe not. But perhaps your demonstration of personal courage is waiting to test you just around the next corner. Sometimes that test is thrust upon you. When President John Kennedy was asked how he became a war hero, he answered, "It was involuntary. They sunk my boat." Yet it is more likely that your personal courage challenges will come in a less spontaneous and hopefully less dangerous test of bravery. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. spoke of ongoing struggles and stepping up and doing the right thing. He said the ultimate measure of a person is not where they stand in moments of comfort and convenience, but where they stand at times of challenge and controversy. Believing those words has changed my life. And so I speak out. I advocate. It's not because I'm a former governor. It's because I'm a current citizen. And when I get weary and am tempted to back away from my longtime commitments and causes, thinking at my age it's time for someone else to carry the load, when I think of that, I pause. And I think about my son Mike. And I accept another chance to speak, like today. I walk another mile for AIDS research or for peace or for ALS or for women's equality. And I accept a brand new position as finance chair for Special Olympics of Oregon. I am not ready yet to forego my chance to advocate for a better Oregon. And let me add here, I know well, you might not think I know this, but I know well that being a doctor doesn't mean you don't have time to be a contributing citizen. You just heard it from our governor, Dr. Alan Bates. Senator Alan Bates, both roles performed with intelligence, dedication, and believe me, personal courage. And Dr. Paul O'Crone and Dr. Paul Aversano and Dr. John Steiger, practitioners of quality, leaders of courage, they and others in the DO community made a dream a reality when this university opened its doors and was welcomed into the Lebanon community. That dream and their courage changed the life of many people in this state. It changed the medical history of Oregon, and their leadership actions changed the lives of hundreds of potential osteopathic physicians, not to mention the thousands of patients who are able to put their health in the hands of practicing DOs. So today, I encourage you, I urge you to be ready and willing to stand up and speak out, and when needed, to take a risk. Take a risk to create a community, a state, a nation that is more humane, more safe, more inclusive, and more honest. Don't be afraid to rock the boat a little. Don't fear to color outside the lines occasionally. Understand what it means to have history be your judge. As I said in my inaugural address as governor, each generation has but one chance to be judged by future generations, and this is our time. And now, this is your time. Make a difference, make us proud, be the finest of doctors, and be the finest of citizens. Congratulations, we are so, so proud of you. Thank you.
Well, extraordinary. I have to echo Dean Crone's observation that this is truly historic to have two remarkable women governors on stage with us sharing their vision and wisdom, and now the newest alumni of Western University of Health Sciences. But enough of that, now we get to the fun part. Would anyone care for a diploma?
Now, will the candidates for the degree of Doctor of Osteopathic Medicine please rise and stand in place? Mr. President, the assembled candidates have met the requirements for graduation and have been recommended by our faculty for the degree of Doctor of Osteopathic Medicine. It is my pleasure to present them to you.
Thank you, Dean Crone. Graduates, by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees, I hereby confer upon you, as you individually present yourselves, the degree of Doctor of Osteopathic Medicine, with all the rights, honors, and privileges appertaining thereto. Will the graduates please come to the stage?
Dr. Robert Dow Elder. Dr. Braden John Healy. Dr. Nicole Renee Shirley. Dr. Dr. Megan Christine Smith.
Dr. Jessica Lynn Arcanti. Dr. Alexander Thomas Alverzano. Dr. Shayan Azimi. Dr. David Abraham Baltazar. Dr. Marissa Ann Bylane. Dr. Alexis Whitney Buffington. Dr. Lauren L. Bayan. Dr. Zachary Lawrence Chelsky. Dr. Quan Ju Chen. Dr. Heather J. Christensen. Dr. April Christine Cutcraft. Dr. Patrick McGinn Conway. Thank you. Dr. Jennifer Lee Darnell. Dr. Julie Elena Davidson. Dr. Keely Dinsey. Dr. Suzanne E. Dysart. Dr. Patrick Ivor Erickson. Dr. Marcus Robert Eschelbach. Dr. Sterling Grant Ferrer. Dr. Laura Maureen Fisher. Dr. Benjamin Caleb Fleming. Dr. Christina Kathleen Fong. Dr. Abigail Errol Fulton. Dr. Melissa Ruth Gabler. Dr. Miranda Lee Gathright.
Dr. Maggie Marie Girk. Dr. Scott Kelly Goddard. Dr. Sarah Ashley Green. Dr. Kiera Yvonne Hayes. Dr. Gabriel Lane Holcomb. Dr. Jessica Lynn Hu. Dr. Jory David Johnson. Dr. Amir Mohsen Jarabchi. Dr. Christopher John Jariff. Dr. Ian Randall Keck. Dr. Zachary Patrick Karoski. Dr. Jonathan Adam Kirsch. Dr. Kelsey Ann Lau. Dr. Cody Victor Lavadier. Dr. Austin Taylor Lawrence. Dr. Jonathan Hanman Lee. Dr. Jacob Cameron LaRue. Dr. Chang C. Liu. Dr. Joanne Meredith Mayberry. Dr. Kelsey Morgan McClure. Dr. Zoe Catalina Moss. Dr. Robert Lutfi Muselli. Dr. Joshua Christian Nelson. Dr. Charles Som Nguyen. Dr. Howard Nguyen.
Dr. Nam Lin Nguyen. Dr. Jordan Nizar Nomi. Dr. Joel Andrew Ort. Dr. Peter Lewis Overton Harris. Dr. Christine Doyen Park. Dr. Sachi Dilip Patel. Dr. Jacqueline Marie Pike. Dr. Charles A. Price. Dr. Derek R. Redinger. Dr. Laureen Elizabeth Reed. Dr. Jeremy M. Reed. Dr. Morgan Paula Rickey. Dr. Elizabeth Claire Richardson. Dr. Stephen Kevin Richardson. Dr. Peter Wilm Rinney. Dr. Stephanie Lynn Rinney. Dr. Elizabeth Atlee Robb. Dr. Dylan Ryan Rogers. Yeah. Dr. Ann O. Rufo. Dr. Michael B. Saleh. Dr. David Allen Sanders. Dr. Lauren Elizabeth Sailors. Dr. Clinton James Schaefer. Dr. Corey J. Schmitz. Dr. Derek James Schultz.
Dr. Elizabeth Sky Severinson. Dr. Aisha A. Shamsi. Dr. Paul Scholler. Dr. Renee Ann Steed. Dr. Daniel Lloyd Stenberg. Dr. Hillary L. Swift. Dr. Wesley C. Tang. Dr. Fardis Ferris Tamangari. Dr. Maximilian Jack Taylor. Dr. Jamie Ann Thompson. Dr. Jessica L. Thornton.
Jessica!
Dr. Casey Jalbert Timmerman. Dr. Derek Oliver Titus. Dr. Kayla Lynn Tenise. Dr. Jenny Ka Tran. Dr. Brittany Callista Van Osdal. Dr. David Wang. Dr. Christina Mary Warner. Dr. Quinn Andrea Watt. Dr. Caleb Michael West. Dr. Matthew Christian White. Dr. Megan Rebecca Witt. Dr. Jamie Lynn Wilkinson.
Ladies and gentlemen, in 1982, the first commencement was held for the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific in Pomona, California, and its very first graduate was Dr. Richard Bond, who is currently serving as chairman of WesternU's Board of Trustees. Today, we are honored that Dr. Bond will be awarding a diploma to the 500th graduate to receive a degree at WesternU's Oregon campus from the College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific Northwest, Dr. Morgan Cameron Weimer.
Dr. Joel T. Yost.
Mr. President, I present to you our graduates from the class of 2019. Let's have another round of applause. I now invite our Comp Northwest Vice Dean, Dr. Pham, to the podium.
It is my pleasure to introduce Mark Shirley D.O., class of 1989 from West Salem Family Practice in Salem, Oregon, who will lead the class in the osteopathic oath. So at this time, I invite all osteopathic physicians in the audience and those on the platform who wish to renew their osteopathic oath to stand with Dr. Shirley and this class of 2019. And now, would the new osteopathic physicians please rise?
Thank you. Please join me. You can follow along if you like to page 99 of your book. I do hereby affirm my loyalty to the profession I am about to enter. Go ahead and please join me. I do by
I do hereby affirm my loyalty to the profession I'm about to enter. I will be mindful always of my great responsibility to preserve the health and the life of my patients, to retain their confidence and respect, both as a physician and a friend, who will guard their secrets with scrupulous honor and fidelity, to perform faithfully to my professional duties, to employ only those recognized methods of treatment consistent with good judgment and with my skill and ability, keeping in mind always nature's laws and the body's inherent capacity for recovery. I will be ever vigilant in aiding the general welfare of the community, sustaining its laws and institutions, not engaging in any of those practices which might in any way bring shame or discredit upon myself or my profession. I will give no drugs for deadly purposes to any person, though it be asked of me. I will endeavor to work in accord with my colleagues in a spirit of progressive cooperation, and never by word or act cast imputations upon them or their rightful practices. I will look with respect and esteem upon those who have taught me my art. I will, to my college, I will be loyal and strive always for its best interests and for the interests in the students who will come after me. I will be ever alert to further the application of basic biologic truths to the healing arts and to develop principles of the osteopathic medicine as taught by my profession. In the presence of this gathering, I bind myself to my oath. Thank you.
Please be seated. It is now my pleasure to introduce Jeffrey Buckley, D.O. He's a member of our inaugural Clump Northwest class of 2015. Dr. Buckley is an internal medicine physician at Mosaic Medical in Bend, Oregon. He will bring a welcome from the WesternU Alumni Association.
Well, thank you, Dr. Pham. It really is an honor to be here, and I want to just congratulate all of you, first of all. But first, I'd like to address and thank a few people whom we all wouldn't be here without. President Wilson, Provost Googlechuck, Chairman Bond, the Board of Trustees, Dean Crone, the Advisory Board, as well as all the administrators, faculty, staff, the graduates, and their families and friends in attendance. Now, I once gave advice to a few aspiring medical students comparing the rigors of medical school and pacing the workload to the consumption of a few daily pancakes. Some of you may remember that. That it's doable as long as you don't get too far behind or let the stack get too high to successfully take on in a reasonable time frame. Now, as medical school graduates, I can proudly congratulate you on successfully finishing those many stacks of flapjacks along the way. It's now time for the next phase of your lives and training, to take the knowledge and skill sets that you've gained and apply them to the many specialties that you are about to embark on in residencies and in fellowships. You have learned and acquired skill sets for the fundamentals and building blocks of medicine. I want to encourage you that although you've now succeeded at something that relatively few people can say they have accomplished, you have reached the tip of the iceberg, and now the journey is just getting started. I encourage you to never stop learning and to never stop asking questions. Get comfortable being uncomfortable. Keep an open mind. Be humble and always willing to hear the advice and criticism from others. You may be surprised where it takes you. Be a lifelong learner and always maintain your interest in medicine as a scientist, but never forget why you embarked on this journey. Reflect back on your personal statements that you wrote just a few short years ago. They likely involved a compassion for humanity and helping others. Remember that the art of medicine is just as important as the science. Never forget your humanity, caring, and concern for others. Be prepared to be accountable for everything that you do. Be prepared to welcome your patient's participation in decisions about their care. The word doctor comes from Latin term docere, meaning to teach, not to heal. No one learns as much about a subject as one who's forced to teach it. We spend much of our day teaching patients about medicine, their lives, and how to prevent disease. We also need to teach concepts to families, colleagues, and medical students. It is our responsibility not only to devote our professional energies to our patients' need, but also to the unmet health needs of society as a whole. Be honest and real. Your patients will suffer greatly from the consequences of their own poor choices, their habits, and their actions. It is your job to help them respond to these consequences in healthier ways. Be kind, and never forget this. Be nice to each other, and remember, the specialist that you're consulting or the primary care doctor who's calling you again was once your lab partner or a member of your study group. Be compassionate. The patient comes first and is always the most important person in the equation. Take time to get to know your patients. They really do put a lot of trust in you and respect what you have to say. Having them feel that you're interested in their lives and their future can make it a tremendous amount of difference. Now, this endeavor of graduate medical training is not meant to be easy. Never forget why you are here and the accompanying gratification that comes with this work. I'd like to share a quote from Dr. William Francis. While the journey seems long and hard at the beginning, with perseverance and dedication, the rewards at the end last a lifetime. It is now my pleasure to officially welcome you as alumni of Western University of Health Sciences. Will the members of the class of 2019 please rise? Now, to signify your accomplishments and change in status from students to alumni, please move your tassel from the right side of your cap to the left, placing it over your heart. Congratulations and welcome to the Western University of Health Sciences Alumni Association.
You may be seated. Congratulations, graduates. I've been waiting 4 years to say that to you. I never fail to feel hopeful and proud as I watch you walk across the stage and receive your diplomas. What a journey it has been. And how fast time has flown. I recall so clearly my own graduation day, my family gathered together, my dad hooding me, memories that I will always cherish. Graduates, we have been humbled frequently as we watched you learn and grow, gain confidence, find your voices, and work so hard to become the physicians you are striving to be. And we are proud of each and every one of you. 4 years ago, you started your medical school journey with all the anxiety and trepidation that naturally accompanies such a big step. It didn't take long before some of you questioned your decision, wondering if you were really up for this task. Despite the challenges and the self-doubts, you never gave up. You traversed those long days of study as you discovered the wonders of the human form and conquered each rite of passage. You learned how to drink from that proverbial fire hose as you navigated through all of your courses and the layers of learning interwoven through them. And without realizing it, you were no longer that pre-med student with a college student's mentality. You were becoming part of something bigger as you began down the path of the very serious and the noble profession of medicine, where everything you learn and everything you do has future implications. Over time, you started resonating with your chosen profession. That white coat across your shoulders started to feel like it belonged, and your stethoscope and your scrubs became an extension to your wardrobe, symbols of medicine that you will carry with you the rest of your lives. You are no longer the same person you were before medical school. You have grown as you have learned to face life and death situations, and as you've bared witness to joy and sorrow and everything in between. You are ready to head into the world of medicine with a hard-earned degree, DO after your name, and the ability to make changes to the world because of the education that you have received. One of you might define the next best approach to the diabetic or stroke patient, or perhaps discover a cure for cancer. All of you have been given the foundation to care for your patients with a humanistic and a caring approach. As you do your own reflection, remember those special individuals who helped get you here today, those that never gave up on you, who taught you those unforgettable, hard-learned lessons, those that pushed you, and those that believed in you. Treasure them and thank them. Never stop learning, and never forget that you have the ability to make a difference. And never stop caring. Don't be afraid to share your love for your fellow person and to work to make your corner of the world a better place. And look around you. Your classmates are now some of your lifelong friends. And in fact, in this class, I think we set the record for married couples. Cherish and hold tight to each other. Your journey together is not finished. In fact, it is just beginning. Your patients and your communities will come to recognize you as one of those special physicians, those caring, compassionate, humanistic doctors that no one expected still existed. I am very proud to say that they do, and that each and every one of you will carry that forward. Now, my final dean's charge to this class of 2019. I charge you to be extraordinary, to be exceptional, and to settle for nothing less. You all have it in you to do so. I charge you to be courageous, to be leaders in your communities, and always, always the champions of your patients. I charge you to be healers, not just doctors, to seek wellness, not just to treat disease. I charge you to be proud osteopathic physicians, to be proud of who you are, where you come from, and where you are going. I charge you not to only stand on the shoulders of the giants like Dr. Googlechuck that came before you, but to become the giant yourself so that others may stand upon your shoulders. Always strive for excellence and always keep your standards set high. Your osteopathic medical education will serve you well. Now, as you heard me say 4 years ago and many times in between, never forget to practice with purpose, passion, and skill, to use your head, hands, and your heart to listen and to care. And I charge each and every one of you to always remember, at the end of every action, every thought, every deed, there is your patient. Thank you for the honor of serving as your dean. It has truly been a privilege. And congratulations, doctors.
Thank you, Dr. Crone. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you our graduates of 2019. Please be seated. Well, there we have it. As I watched each of you receive your diplomas, cross this stage, and be hooded by a loved one, colleague, or mentor, I was reminded anew of how no one passes through this life alone. Each of us has leaned on others when times were tough, have been sounding boards or helping hands for those in need, especially those for whom aid in need is difficult to find. We have all celebrated success, commiserated failure with those who know us best. These years of study have included all such highs and lows that life entails, certainly for our graduates, their families, and their friends. So I ask all the husbands and wives, the children, the significant others, the parents, grandparents, family, and friends here today, please rise, rise and let our graduates acknowledge you for all you have given to help them reach their goal. Graduates, your dedication and commitment to your calling has thrown open doors to opportunity, service, and success. You now have the gifts to make meaningful improvements to the health and lives of those you touch. You have the skills, the attitude, and the energy to serve all those who seek your aid. You are poised for success, not only of the material type, but also of the personal and even spiritual. As Hypatia of Alexandria, the first woman philosopher about whose life we know in any detail, stated millennia past, life is an unfoldment. The further one travels, the more one encounters the truth. You will leave this auditorium today as our newest members of the osteopathic profession. This is not some accident into which just anyone could have walked. You chose a life of compassionate, humanistic service to others. But never forget, this life also chose you. It was you who was meant to offer a kind word, an understanding ear, a healing touch. It was you who was chosen not just for your skilled hands, but for your caring heart. It was you upon whom now great authority and responsibility is placed to be exercised with dignity, humility, and grace. So let me close with the sound advice from William Shakespeare, who urged that we love all, trust few, do wrong to none, have patience, and perhaps most importantly, endure. I wish you Godspeed in every possible happiness, fulfillment, and success. With this, I declare these commencement exercises closed.
Ladies and gentlemen, for those who are able, please stand and remain at your seats until the recessional is fully complete.
Thank you.
us today to celebrate the class of 2019 of Western University of Health Sciences College of Osteopathic Medicine of the Pacific Northwest. We now invite you to join us at the Comp Northwest campus for our open house.